okay, we got it to run. Let's say we didn't get it to run. What's the problem? Well, double check your wiring diagram. So I've made a wiring diagram. I'm going to put it on the screen here. You can study this. Again, this is 14 gauge wire. The hookup wire is 14 gauge wire right here. I like to use black for negative and red for positive. Doesn't matter. 3-volt batteries. So check your wiring hookup. If you're unsure of your wiring hookup, there's a couple of books I can recommend. This is the Atkinson Cycle Engine by Vincent Gingery. And he gives a complete drawings and instructions on how to cast parts, make patterns, cast parts, and build this engine. Quite a few of these have been built. They do run. And inside here, he gives the wiring diagram for an ignition using, I believe, a 6-volt motorcycle battery and coil. So let's put that up there. I can recommend this book. Even if you're not going to build an engine, you just want to enjoy studying them and how they run. It's a good book. So there's an article in 1936 Popular Mechanics, the Midget Gas Engine. I think it's October and November issues. 1936 Popular Mechanics. This has a diagram on wiring up your engine. And you can see in this one, he has a switch. This author uses a switch. I'm just using an alligator clip that I hooked to the wire. So another book that's great for information, this is online now, is Model Engine Builder Magazine. This is an online magazine. Where's that glare coming from? So in Model Engine Builder Magazine, I found an ad for the miniature spark plugs, the rimfire. Now I'm not sure that these are still available from this vendor. They are still available. Roland in Benton City, Washington. I don't think that's still operating. I'm not sure, but they are available online. But this is a great source of information. In this magazine, there's an ad for the back issues of Strictly IC magazine. Strictly IC is Strictly Internal Combustion. And this particular issue of Model Builder was August 2007. So, you know, a lot of this material is dated. But there are Strictly IC issues out there. That's an excellent magazine. It gets really into the nitty-gritty of model engine constructing, and there are back issues available on eBay from time to time. It's a very valuable resource, Strictly IC magazine. Anyway, by the way, here's a copy I have. I copied this out of the library years ago, the microfiche. This was the 10cc model gas engine. The drawings for this engine, very accurate. They're tiny. You're going to need a magnifying glass. But the drawings are in this issue of it's a 1946 Popular Mechanics magazine. You know, you'll have to make patterns or you have to make castings. But this is a great running engine. The carburetor drawings were sold separately by Cole's Power Models. But in the magazine article, the carburetor drawings and dimensions are included. So this is Popular Mechanics 1946, October, November issues. There was a two-part article, by the way. October and then November. Yep, October, November. So the second article is November 1946. October, November 1946, Popular Mechanics. You can build one of these. I think originally it was designed to run smaller class model tether boats, but it is air-cooled. It'd be pretty easy to change it over to water-cooled. Highland County Public Library. Anyway, all these Popular Mechanics magazines are now available online. You can go on online for free. If you type in model gas engine in the search archives of Popular Mechanics magazine. We're going to say now that you can't get it started. So here's some things to check. Troubleshooting. You've eliminated the simple stuff. You've got fuel. Your batteries. Are your batteries good? That's one of the things to check. You tested your batteries and they were good. By the way, if you don't have a digital voltmeter, these are... get a digital one. They're so easy to read and they work. They're cheap. I think Harbor Freight, these are like $6.95. The first thing you want to do is check your individual batteries. Make sure they're really up, they're up to par. And this one's 1.4 volts that I have in here. It's reading 1.5 volts. That's good. Check your battery, individual batteries, but then don't neglect to check your battery. Check the positive and negative as it comes out of the battery box here. I've got my little alligator clip here, and I'm gonna put it on the ground on the engine. And you want 3 volts. I'm only shows here 2.8. That you want 3 if you can possibly get it. And the more you have, the better. Check that. Check your coil. You don't want to mount this coil on metal. Let's say you made a mount out of metal and you mounted your coil to maybe you have a welding bench or a steel workbench, that steel will throw off the field in the coil. It also short out the positive and negative on this particular one if you mount it or set it on metal. So don't set the coil on metal mount. That will mess up the coil. See here, I have my coil mounted on wood. So if you mount your coil on metal, it could short it out or just mess up the field. Because all this is two coils of wire, right? So don't mount this on metal. So you check your batteries. Your batteries are good. Your coil's not mounted on metal. All your wires and solder connections are good. What else? So here's another trick. This occurs with the full-size car engines. What you want to do is turn your lights down or off as low as you can in your workshop. Turning off the lights. I have to leave some on so I can video. Turn your engine over. You can turn it over by hand or you can turn it over with the drill. And what you want to check is for sparks. Look all around the engine while you're turning it over. Look in the back. Look especially around the points and where they contact or come close to engine or wires. These sparks will jump. This is especially true if you have an electronic ignition with a 6-volt, 4.5-volt coil and a 6-volt battery. A lot of the engine more and Banggood engines, they really kick a spark out, and that spark will arc. Quite frequently it arcs between the top of the spark plug and the valves, or the valve coils, the top of the head. They come so close. These engines are so small, that spark can jump that gap, and that will completely, the spark's not happening in the right spot, so it's not going to run. That's a confounding problem, because with all the lights on bright daylight, maybe you're doing it outside, you can't see that. By the way, if your car has a strange miss in it, you can do the same thing. Pull the car in or at night, open the hood and let it run. You can see that blue spark jumping across from the one of the spark plug wires grounding itself out on the crankcase or somewhere else. But turn the lights down, turn the engine over, and check for that spark arcing, leaking. I think they call it leak, sparking over. turn it over, check for that spark. It's a great way to do it with the lights out. So you're still trying to get it to run, and you've checked all this over. The gap is set just right at the point, 15 thousandths. Spark is timed to fire at top dead center, or 5 degrees before. You've got fuel. Your coil's not shorted out to a metal bench or metal. Your batteries are good. Your battery box is good. Your switch is good because you're just using clamps, or you know the switch is good because you checked it. You've got 3 volts. Keep trying. Oh, by the way, if you have that arc happening, how do you fix it? If the spark is leaking, re-insulate the wires with electrical tape or heat shrink tubing.
Use some heat shrink tubing. You can buy it in various sizes.
And insulate the wire. You can use model airplane fuel tubing to insulate the spark plug. Rubber tubing, rubber hose. Get that insulation on there. Try it again to make sure in the dark so you don't see any leaky sparks jumping over the gap. Keep trying. Don't give up. You will be rewarded with the beautiful sound of your engine coming to life, and it's quite exciting when you've built an engine or restored one and it fires back up for the first time.